what is spiritual journey? When I talk to different people, they give me very different definitions of a spiritual journey. So maybe I am talking of something different because I am trying to share with you what the definition of spirituality was as given by great master Hazur Maharaj Baba Sravan Singh, my master. But people have different ideas. For example, some people think spiritual means something connected with spirits. And spirits are considered to be ghosts. I remember somebody sent me a cartoon recently with a big picture of a wine shop where it was written, "Spirits sold here." And three ghosts were flying away from there, running away. So then some people say spirits are actually related to wine. And they quote Jesus Christ for that. They quote Umar Khayyam for that. They quote Jalaluddin Rumi. We consider them to be mystics, spiritual teachers. And they, in their poetry, have talked about wine and intoxication. So people think maybe just having some extra wine or going to the bar is a spiritual journey. But some people go even further. And they quote the great Indian mystic Bulle Shah. Bulle Shah not only went to a wine shop, he bought wine. It's an old story, some of you may have heard of it, that Bulle Shah decided one day to go to a wine shop and ask for wine for 2 paisa, which was a very small amount. And the bartender there said, 2 paisa will not give you enough even to touch your teeth. You will not be able to drink anything. He said, I don't want to drink. I want to put on my mustache so that people can smell and know that I am intoxicated because of the wine. And then there was a prostitute who was his disciple. He asked her for a favor. He said, will you be able to walk with me down the street one day? She said, certainly, master. So the prostitute is walking with Bulle Shah in the street. He's smelling of liquor. And all the people are surprised. What has happened to him? They say, he's not a mystic anymore. He is not a saintly person. Look at his life, what he's doing, walking with a prostitute, all drunk. And his followers followed him. Many left him, that he's not a saint at all. Some kept on following him. And when they reached the destination, his closest follower said, Bulle Shah, what did you do? And his answer was very simple. In Indian language, we understand it better. He says, when you have a platter of sweets, flies tend to come on them. It's also necessary to wave away the flies. So I was waving away the flies who come to me merely out of curiosity and not because they are seekers. Then his disciples asked him, but what about the seekers? They go away also. He said, if they had gone away, why are you here with me? You still followed me. You knew that this is not something that's real, but it's just put up to keep those away who are not really interested. Why do these people create unnecessary scandal about themselves? My own master, great master, Baba Sravan Singh, when he was originally installed, he picked up 3 young girls to come and help him. And there were newspaper cuttings saying, he's not a saint. He's carrying some kind of a sex orgy or something with 3 women there and a group of people around him. And that those news came in the newspapers. And people said, don't you bother about it? He says, no, you should. Then he told the story of Bulle Shah. And one of his very famous disciple, who was a doctor, veterinary doctor, whose stories you might have heard, Dr. Ishar Singh, the man who tied up his dad to bring him for the darshan, the man who wanted some other boons from the great master, that great doctor, veterinary doctor, he was one of the early disciples. When he heard that these young girls are coming to the great master, he said he could not be a master if he's keeping these young girls and doing all this kind of stuff, and newspapers are carrying such news. Therefore, he and a friend of his decided that at night, there was a very small room in which Great Master was living in the Dera. There were only two rooms in the whole Dera. And they had ventilators, like we have windows, those houses there have top ventilators, they are like windows at the top. They decided that at night they are going to see what happens when one of the women who brings milk for him at night, when she comes in, what will happen. So there was a barbed wire around that house. So he and his friend decided to take a pair of, what are those things called, on which you put the feet and...
Stools.
Ladder. No, not a ladder, but people walk on those. Whatever the name is, you understand. And the friend said, "You hold me," because he was not expert in walking on those high sticks. So the friend held him, and Ishar Singh got on that and looked through the ventilator, and he saw one lady who was later on in charge of the kitchen and served food for Great Master all her life and all his life. That lady walks in, and he's very keen to see what happened next. And then the lady talks to Great Master, who's in his bed, and she says, "Master, people are talking all kinds of things against you, even against us who are serving you." And the Great Master says, "Kako," this is his way of addressing young people, "I want to tell you, to be on the spiritual path, you have to be a warrior. If you are easily influenced by what people say, you are not a fit candidate for this path. It's a path for very strong people. It's a path for those who have found their destined goal is to go back home and not worry about what is happening in a local drama in a created universe that we're living in right now." And she said, "Thank you very much," and walked out. When this happened, he was so shocked at this conversation. He moved like this. The other guy thought that somebody has come to catch them. So he tried to leave the sticks and ran away. So Ishar Singh felt right on the barbed wire, got all scratched. And next morning he appeared before Master, says, "Master, I tried a trick on you last night. It didn't work. Look, I have injured myself so much." And Great Master laughingly said, "Well, we have to pay a price for every lesson we learn." So I am only telling you these stories to tell that the spiritual path we talk of is not what we are saying, that the spirit is the spiritual drink that we are having. Some people carry it further. They take drugs. Right now there are shamans sitting in South America, in Peru particularly. They're giving ayahuasca and some other things and say you get a completely spiritual experiences. Those experiences are very non-physical experiences, but nothing to do with spirituality at all. When you come back after that experience, and there are a large number of people who keep on telling me of their experiences, when you come back, you are a square one. Your life is still the same. Your anger is still the same. Your possessiveness is still the same. All the weaknesses we have are still exactly the same. Spirituality, true spirituality, changes all this. It makes you a new person. So that is why the drugs don't work like this. When I was at Harvard University, there were two professors, and they thought that spirituality can be achieved by trying some Mexican mushrooms, because they gave similar kind of out-of-body effects. So they tried, Richard Alpert, Timothy Leary, and I had conversations with them all the time. And ultimately, they did drop the drugs and went to look for real spirituality. And Richard Alpert went to India, met Neem Karoli Baba there, and then he became Baba Ram Das. And he wrote books on spirituality, saying it's not the drug that gave him all this. But they were calling that spirituality also. So what is spirituality according to Great Master? I want to explain that today. Because that is what we are talking of when I say a spiritual journey.